second floor of the Western as we continue to move through the Atlantic Division. Wake Forest has now joined us in the room. Folks, even though you may have a relationship with some of our coaches and players, please identify yourselves. For those watching remotely today, that would be a great help. Our first question for Coach Clawson will be to your left, third row.
Hello, hello.
Bob Holliday, WRL.com, Coach. The commissioner said this morning that bowls matter in the Atlantic Coast Conference. What impact did your win over a Big Ten team, one of just two ACC bowl victories, have on your offseason preparation?
The bowl games are rewards for a good season. I was an FCS head coach for 9 years, and the playoffs are wonderful, and they're a great experience, but they're another football game. The bowl games are a reward and an experience and a bonding week that's unique to college football. And to finish a season with a win, especially the chance to go against a Big Ten team, and we were looking forward to competing against an SEC team, and then that changed the week before the game, and then we had the opportunity to play a Big Ten team, and that was a really good win for our program, and I think the ACC. So yes, bowls are important, and not just for the games and the competition, but for the experience that the student athletes get to have.
Coach, to your left, first row.
Dan Tortora, wakeupcalldt.com. How you doing, Coach?
I'm doing well. Good to see you again.
Good to see you, too. Looking at the fact that divisions are going to exist one more time this season in the ACC, and then we're going to the 3-5-5 model, would love to get your thoughts on the future and just what that can do for this conference. Like you said, the postseason and bowls matter, so just what you could say about that.
I think like with every decision, there's positives and there's things you gain, and then there's also things that you lose. I think if you take the division votes every year, the Atlantic was for eliminating it and the Coastal was for keeping it. And I think the scheduling model, there's positives. One of the positives for us is we get to play North Carolina more often. That's a game that's part of our history and part of the Big Four in North Carolina football, and the fact that we were only playing them once every 6 years got us to schedule them non-conference. So the fact that we get to play a team like Carolina more often is definitely a positive. But you gain something and you lose something. And what we lose is we've played North Carolina State for 110 straight years. And to see a game like that end is a negative. And so again, you gotta do what's best for the conference. I think for our players, for them to know that in their 4 years at Wake Forest, they'll get to play against every ACC team, home and away, is clearly a positive, and I think the overall is good. But like with any decision or changes, there are some things that you hate to see disappear.
Coach, we're going to stay heavy on the right side for the next couple of questions. About the fourth row, gentleman standing.
Coach Essex there with the old Golden Black. Last season, especially in the latter portion, student engagement was through the roof. I mean, student attendance was at an all-time high. How do you capitalize on that this season and continue to have students show up in droves for these games?
Well, thanks for the question. And our last two games, I think over 90% of the students at Wake Forest showed up for the game. So I'd like to see any other school in the country boast those type of numbers. And the engagement level was incredible, and that's one of the unique aspects of coaching at Wake Forest. When you're at such a small school and a smart school, that our players know these other students, they go to class with them, they live with them, and the engagement gave us energy. I think it brought value to the entire university. Just as impressive were the 25 or 30 buses that we filled up to play right down the road in Charlotte in the ACC championship game. So my hope is the students had such a good time last year coming to our game, celebrating with our team after games, that now that just becomes part of their habit and part of their social experience and being a student at Wake Forest, that you go to football games.
Keep your attention on that side, Coach. Gentleman standing.
Hey, Coach. Colin Wilson with the Action Network. You bring in Brad Lambert as defensive coordinator. He's been amazing. He's been Charlotte, Purdue, Marshall. He's increased their defenses to be havoc-minded. Do you see any changes in his defense with you being organization, and what drew you to get Coach Lambert?
You know, really, when I looked for a defensive coordinator, there was kind of three check marks that I was looking for. One was somebody that had successful experience as a Power Five coordinator. I think the program where it is now, we're past a point to take a chance on an up-and-comer and hope it works out. And obviously the work Brad did at Wake Forest, did at Marshall, did at Purdue, and as the head coach of Charlotte, he was a proven commodity. I want somebody that understood what it was like to work at a school like Wake Forest. And it didn't have to be Wake Forest, but an academic private school, there's a certain type of player that we have to recruit that fits the school, and Brad understands that. And then the third piece of it was just regional recruiting. He spent so much of his career in the Southeast that he's been in the high schools in the areas that we recruit. And he's a great fit. I think we'll be more aggressive than we've been in the past. Certainly with the way we play on offense, you know, it's going to be hard to ever be the top-ranked defense in the ACC just because we play more plays. By the same token, I think we're capable of a lot of improvement on that side of the ball, and I'm very comfortable and confident that we're going to get there with Coach Lambert and the staff that he brought in.
Coach, right up the aisle to the right, the gentleman standing.
Hey, Coach, Miles Williams of the three-point conversion. With the changing of the perception of Wake Forest football and being nationally ranked going into this season, what's the biggest thing you give your team as far as mindset and sort of staying humble and grounded?
Well, you said it. Our theme for this year is mindset. And every year we come to these media days and people have low expectations of us, and we never let that dictate how we went about our weekly process or our preparation. That we had confidence we could be a good football team, maybe despite what people on the outside thought. And now that people have a different perception of us, we welcome that, but it can't change the way that we operate. It can't change our mindset and the way that we go about our daily tasks and our preparation. So, you know, we're 9 years in, and if you're at a place for 9 years, if the expectations aren't higher, you're probably not there anymore. So we welcome those expectations, but our team has to be mature and make sure that, you know, nothing's given, everything's earned. And so we've got to remain humble and yet stay hungry and never ever be satisfied with where we're at. And I think with the leadership that we have here today, I'm very comfortable and confident that that will happen.
We've got about 5 minutes left with Coach. Coach, right up the aisle to your left, about the fifth row.
Hey, Coach, Scout Hughes, WBRF. In regards to the 3-5-5 format, how satisfied were you to get the three permanent opponents, Duke, Virginia Tech, and Georgia Tech?
Again, those are programs we all have respect for. You know, Duke has been a team that we've played every year. They've been our crossover opponent since the ACC went to division, so it was great to see that one. Virginia Tech is 2 hours away. That's a game that our fan base has always traveled well to, and their fan base has always supported their football team. And certainly our alumni base and our recruiting that we do in Atlanta certainly made Georgia Tech a good and ideal opponent for us. So again, we're excited to have those three opponents. We're excited that we get to play North Carolina more often. But I hate to see 110-year traditions ended. I know for our football team, you know, the NC State game is always a really important game. They've got a good program. They're very competitive. There's a lot of players on our team that grew up and went to high school and played with or against people at NC State. So that to me is the only drawback.
Coach, to your left, second row.
Hey, Dave, Steve Reed from the Associated Press. Especially in this division, it seems like loaded with quarterbacks, and you got one of your own. I wonder if you can speak to the depth at the quarterback position throughout the conference and this division, as well as what your expectations are of Sam.
It's a really good year for quarterbacks in the ACC, and we have a lot of teams that we play against that have great quarterbacks coming back, and we feel we're in as good a position as anybody in the conference or the country at that position. So Sam has played at a very high level for a number of years. What people don't see about Sam that I see on a daily basis is how he's elevated his teammates, how he's invested into the younger receivers and running backs and offensive linemen. The amount of time that he spends with younger players allows a Torian Perry to have the year that he had. And so as much as Sam has improved physically, I think his arm strength, his accuracy, his ability to throw the deep ball, he's faster, he's quicker. Every physical measurement of a quarterback, he's improved every year. The big difference for him on our football team is just his leadership qualities. He's become such a good leader for our program, and I think Michael Jurgens will tell you this, that, you know, Sam's a guy that his teammates like playing with him and for him. You know, that he has developed great relationships with the offensive linemen, our defensive football players. And I always think that leadership is the element that can bond and elevate a football team. And one of the reasons that we've had success at Wake Forest, going to 6 straight bowl games, and the number of wins we've had over the last 5-6 years, we've been very blessed and fortunate to have not good leaders, but great leaders. And our captains next year and the 3 guys at the podium that I'd really like you guys to talk to more than me are great examples of that at Wake Forest.
Coach, you get your wish. So if you'll trade places with Rondell, we'll spend about 5 minutes with him.
Okay.
Thank you. Questions for Rondell from the room. Again, please identify yourselves, even if you've already asked a question here in the room for the Wake Forest squad. Rondell, seeing none in the room, I'm going to ask it from the podium first. You were named team captain in the spring. Describe that feeling, that honor, that responsibility.
It was a great honor to be, because we elect it from the teammates mostly, and it's just a great honor to be elected from my teammates and know that my teammates trust me. And it's a really good honor, because captain's probably the biggest reward you can get on a football team.
All the way down the aisle, Rondell, to your right.
Connor O'Neill with Deacons Illustrated. Rondell, without going into the X's and O's and the nitty-gritty, how different of a defense is it going to be with Brad Lambert this season?
I mean, besides the fact that you can just, you don't really have to think as much at the line of scrimmage. We can just go. I didn't play in the spring, so I haven't played in his defense yet, but just seeing the guys like Deshaun and Kendron just be able to go and make plays is probably the biggest difference. And I'm excited to play in the fall. We started the first. And yeah, I'm just excited to just be able to go and not really think about having to play on the line of scrimmage.
Right in front of you to your left, front row.
Dan Tortora, wakeupcalldt.com. Rondell, just what you can say about 29 turnovers last season, where you feel this defense has improved, though, as you step through the spring and going into 2022, coming off of those successes and now having a new defensive coordinator, where are you seeing those improvements?
As Coach said, I think we're going to be really aggressive this year, so hopefully we can have more turnovers than that, which is 29 is a lot, but just being more aggressive, I think we'll have teams more on the edge of not wanting to turn it over, so which helps a lot. And yeah, I mean, more turnovers would be great, because that's a point of emphasis. That points allowed and third down has been a big point of emphasis this spring.
Rondell, from the podium, in an interview with your high school newspaper this past January, you spoke about your adjustment from high school to college. If you could speak to your younger self today, what would you tell that person?
I'd probably tell them it's more mental, but I'd probably tell them to get more physically ready. Because in Connecticut football is not like the biggest pipeline in college football. So they didn't like lift as much as a Florida school would. So I'd probably tell them to get more physically ready, because you can't really prepare mentally for college football. Probably that.
It's probably pretty good.
Yeah.
Following up though, last year you had 9 games with at least 1 sack. What is it about your game that allows you to get into the backfield so consistently?
I like to just go up the field and not really think about getting the sack before the play, because I feel like I'd psych myself out. And I pride myself on watching a lot of film, so knowing what the guy in front of you is going to do helps a lot, and knowing what the other 4 guys on the line of scrimmage are going to do, it helps a lot, and I think that's part of the reason that I was able to get after the ball so much.
We're going to go to the very back of the room, final row to your left.
My name is Katrina Sack. I'm with Sports and Culture Media. Coach had touched on the possible preconceived ideas that people may have about you or your team. As a team captain, how do you kind of turn that around and use that as a motivating factor? And what would you say are your driving motivators in this game?
Personally, I talked about this earlier. I'm not a big fan of getting like preseason ranks and like being ranked really high because I like playing as an underdog because you play with a chip on your shoulder. But as Coach said, it's just mindset this year and not getting complacent with the fact that we had a good season last year and just getting guys on board and not, obviously not getting complacent, but getting guys on board to want to be better and want to not only just go to the ACC championship, but a national championship is everybody's goal.
Anything else for Rondell? Rondell, seeing none, if you'll trade places with Sam, we appreciate your time. Once again, with our student athlete, we'll introduce yourselves again in the room. Sam, follow the aisle to the right in the back.
Connor O'Neill, Deacons Illustrated. Sam, I've got to ask about the hat. What was the impetus behind bringing the hat?
Big Peaky Blinders fan. It's a peaky cap, you know, not a fedora. It's a toad to Thomas Shelby, and I like the show. I like his attitude. I like his mentality.
Sam, let's stay on the right side, about the seventh row.
Hey, Sam, Colin Wilson with the Action Network. One of the stats that you have, it's amazing. I can't even comprehend. You're 68% adjusted completion percentage when there's no blitz. You're 71% when there is a blitz. Can you tell us what kind of workouts or process or thinking that goes through why your adjusted completion percentage is so much better when you're blitzed?
I think it's a credit to the O-line, you know, running backs. I think when you look at, I think that's where it is. You know, if you're getting blitzed and the O-line and the running backs aren't doing their jobs, you're probably getting hit and you're probably not making throws. So, shout out to Jurgens and the beef boys up front. You know, I like to keep them fed, like to keep them happy. So I think that that's where it starts. And obviously with the schemes that we run, we have great adjustments to blitz. And so Coach Ruggiero has done a great job with that. And obviously as you get more into the offense, you learn how to cope with that. And but I think it really starts up front and the running backs as well.
Sam, left side, about the seventh row.
Hey, Sam, Tony Syracuse from Last Word on College Football. Last year's team theme from the coach was going from good to great. This year it's mindset. As one of the team leaders and really the face of the program right now, how do you get that mindset concept through the rest of the team? What's your role in putting forth coach's theory?
I think it starts with having a coach like Coach Clawson. I think his consistency day in and day out, like you guys probably see, I mean, he's the same person in every interview, every day of practice, every game. I think that mindset for us is consistency. I think for myself, pushing the offense this year, especially in the summer, will be how consistent can we be in our performance, right? We last year pressed ourselves as hard as we could and, ended up coming a little short at the end of the year. But I think that we can, you know, we have other steps. Like A.T. Perry has another step in his game. Donovan Green coming back this year has another step. Blake Whitehart has another step. I believe Michael Jurgens has another step. I believe myself has another step. Justice Ellison, it goes across the board, even on defense as well. So I think that that's one of our biggest pushes is can we be consistent, but can we also make a stride? You know, preseason rankings, whatever. Hope they rank us 12th. Hope they rank us 13th, 14th, 15th. Maybe they don't put us on there. That'd be nice because that's where we live, right? We went to Wake Forest, right? We've changed the culture, like Ethics asked earlier, right? The culture around Wake Forest used to be, it's a great school. You must be smart because you go there. But now it's because you're a good football player who's also pretty smart.
Sam, follow the center aisle to the right.
Just got to yell. Corlin Griffin with 3-point conversion. Sam, we've heard the stats. We've heard, the good, the great. Were you one of those guys who off the field? Off the field, you're a pretty even keel guy. But on the field, you have this like competitive fire that burns that you can see visibly on the field. Is that something that it just comes out of your? Is that just you on the field? Or is that your persona? Period.
I think I've toned it down a little bit. Maybe freshman year I had a little bit more fire, a little bit more trash talk, but I've learned if you trash talk people, they hit you harder. So I've shied away from that. I'm more like to make like a cordial conversation. You know, you have some good conversation with guys out there. So I think you can see it and like, the intensity and the passion. You know, I love the game, I love playing it, and I really enjoy it. I think that's another part of this game is you can have fun doing it while also being successful. And I like pushing our guys, you know, to be great and go good to great and go good to greater, greatest, you know, whatever you want to say. But I think if we have fun this year, I think we'll have a lot of success as well.
Sam, left side, gentleman standing.
What did you miss when Donovan Green was injured, and what are you going to get back? What is the offense going to benefit from with him back from injury this year?
I would put, you know, obviously A.T. Perry, right, we all know is a household name now with his athleticism and his ability to make a play on the ball. But, you know, Donovan Green is special. You know, a kid from Mount Airy that I don't know if I've ever seen somebody so physically gifted as an athlete. And, you know, his makeup genetically is it's nuts, to be honest. And so I think he's got a different, you know, mindset. We're going to say mindset a lot today. He had a different mindset coming in this year, and I think he's a lot more he's matured a lot, and you know, not playing for a while, it really changes the way you see the game, and I think he appreciates it more, and he loves it more, and I'm excited. I mean, it's gonna be a scary sight, you know, those two on the outside.
Sam, last question for the podium. We started on a light note with Connor. We will end on a light note. How do you decide beard or no beard?
Man, I can't get away from non-football questions here. I don't know. I usually just text my mom and ask her what she thinks, and she usually gives me the thumbs up, thumbs down. So we went beard this year.
Mom knows best.
She does.
Sam, thank you. You can change places with Michael. We'll spend about 5 minutes with Michael, then we'll send the Demon Deacons on their way. First question for our O lineman, Richard Jr. We'll start here in the first row to your left, Michael.
Michael, as a team, you were better than 50% on third down conversion. I think it was 53.3. Just what you could say about that and the work in the trenches and those little pieces that you guys know that not everybody obviously is going to see.
Yeah, thanks. You know, third down comes down to a lot of detail and a lot of execution. And we've got a great staff on offense and a lot of continuity there. And they're in the office all summer working on walkthroughs to script us so that we see every possible look. And really, at the end of the day, we say here that third down is a player's down. You're going to get one-on-one matchups. You're going to get one-on-one pass rushes. And players are going to make plays. And one thing we've proven here away is that we got good players. So look for that to continue. But those details really make a difference.
Michael, to your right, about the fourth row.
Hey, Michael Essex there with the Old Golden Black. Other than losing Zach, a lot of consistency on the offensive side of the ball, especially on the offensive line, and you get to have, you know, yourself still snapping the ball to Sam. What does that give you going into this season, just to have that consistency on offense and then just the ability to continue to play well there?
Yeah, thanks. Definitely consistency has been huge. We were talking about this earlier. Our offensive staff hasn't changed the entire time Sam and I have been here, and we're just incredibly fortunate for that. Up front, losing Zach's a huge loss, both on the field and off the field, just a great player and a great guy. But fortunately, we got Giovante Nash coming back, so really we're returning 5 starters when you look at it. That's just great, that continuity. I've been incredibly fortunate to have, going into my third year starting, I've had the same 2 guards next to me every single game. And that doesn't happen a lot in college football or in football in general, and it's been great, and hopefully that continues.
Stay on the right-hand side, just follow the aisle up to the edge.
How you doing? It's Corbin Griffin with 3-point conversion. I know we know that one of the things that is conducive to a good offense is the quarterback-center connection. We also just heard Sam say that he's kind of toned down the trash talk. Does that make that easier for you to block for him when guys aren't gunning for your neck when your quarterback's talking noise behind you?
Yeah, you know, he may say in front of the cameras he's toned down the trash talk. We'll see how that works out on Saturdays. But, you know, we're at this level and in this league, everybody's competing. Everybody wants to win. And at the end of the day, people are going to be coming for him. And when he's got that target on his back, like,
After performing the way he has the past few years and for such a long time, people want to take him down, and we take a lot of pride in protecting him. And you know, just with him back there, we're really confident that we always have a chance. We're always in the fight, and we're really grateful for that.
Our time is starting to run short. To your left, third row.
Bob Holliday, WRL.com. Michael, Wake Forest led the league in red zone offense last year. 62 trips, 43 touchdowns, 14 of 15 Nick Skiba field goals. And, of course, he's one of the few guys not back this year. We've talked about the experience in this offensive line. How important is that experience in maybe producing even more touchdowns in the red zone?
Yeah, thanks, Bob. Red zone is huge for us here. That's one of our keys to win, is close the deal. And for offense, that means scoring touchdowns in the red zone. And that's something we take a lot of pride in. And again, that goes back to, like I talked about on third down, those walkthroughs, scripting that out every Friday morning, every Saturday morning, we have a walkthrough, a red zone walkthrough period that we go through. And just up front, I mean, I've got Sean and Louis with me, and then now Devontae and Javionte on the outside. We just have such a good rapport. You know, I came in mid-year in 2018, and Sean and Louis, who are my two guards, they were the year above me, and they really just took me in. And it's felt like I've been with them this entire time, and they know what I'm thinking before I say it, and vice versa, and just really grateful to have that continuity.
Michael, your last question from the podium. You were born on New Year's Day. This past year, you played on New Year's Eve. How cool of a stretch was that for you?
That was an exciting 24 hours for sure. You know, hopefully down the road this year at some point we're playing on New Year's Day. That's the ultimate goal.
I had that as a follow-up question, but you addressed yeah. It, so thank you. Wake Forest, thank you. Have a good season, and you guys are excused.
Thank you.
Folks, Louisville's due up next at 12:15. Thank you for all your energy. Stand